Welcome to the Aerospace Advantage Podcast. I'm your host, John Slickbaum. Modern air combat is increasingly complex, demanding tremendous situational awareness to make split-second decisions that will make the difference between life and death. And we've talked about it a lot before. In fact, we've highlighted that the old adage of speed is life has changed. The coin of the new realm is information. Pilots don't fly around and miraculously know everything that's going on in the battlespace. It takes sensors to harvest data and processing power to turn it into actionable information. Radio detection and ranging, or radar, is the primary tool that's used to build awareness of what's going on in the battlespace. And radar uses a very specific section of the electromagnetic spectrum. Now, as complex as a fighter radar is, it's really looking for three pieces of information. The radar is trying to find the range, obviously, from the host aircraft out to the target, and then the azimuth and elevation. With these pieces put together, essentially one aircraft is able to engage another, whether it be to complete an intercept or to launch a missile. Now, the downside of radar is the adversary may know that they're being targeted when their radar warning receivers start to go off like an alarm. This is just like the old fuzzbuster radar detectors you may have had on your dashboard to avoid a speeding ticket. Now, you might not have avoided that ticket, but the warning may have enabled you to slow down enough to reduce the pain of the ticket. Just like you knew you were being looked at by a policeman, an enemy aircraft may know that they're being targeted by one of us. And that's because our adversaries understand the radar spectrum, and they do everything in their power to break our detection and tracking to ultimately prevent targeting. And that's what electronic attack is all about. That jamming is trying to confuse the radar waves coming back to manipulate that azimuth, elevation, and range that we talked about earlier. And it's also why they are pursuing stealth. Stealth prevents radar waves from coming back to the host to calculate that triangulation for targeting. So, all of that said, the enemy has ways to stop us from utilizing the radar spectrum to target them. So, for us to maintain an edge, we need to pursue numerous concurrent pathways of sourcing data on the adversary so we aren't reliant on just one spectrum. So, I've gathered a group to discuss a key technology to exploit another area of the electromagnetic spectrum, the infrared spectrum. In this context, it's called infrared search and track, IRST, or IRST for short. It's able to detect, target, and track objects by observing their electromagnetic radiation. In layman's terms, their heat signature. Just like radar, we can find azimuth and elevation and find out where a prospective target is. We're just using a different frequency band to do it. It sounds complex, and in many ways it is. And that is the point of today's episode. We have a panel of experts in the IR spectrum, operators who employ these systems, and the experts that actually build it. We are discussing this so that you can get a better understanding of this key tool because you will be hearing a lot about it in the future. So with that, I'd like to introduce everyone to the show. First off, we have our very own Heather Penny. As you know, Heather flew the F-16 and also looks at the application of new technologies here at Mitchell.
Hey, Slick, it's great to be back. Thanks so much.
We also have Commander Eric McQueen from the U.S. Navy. He is an FA-18 Super Hornet Wizzo, and he is instructed at Top Gun and commanded at the squadron level.
Morning, Slick. Good to be here. Thanks for having me.
And we also have Pat Smack McKenzie of Lockheed Martin, who works in their Missiles and Fire Control Division on this technology. He is also an Air Force veteran with numerous combat tours in the F-16. He's a weapons school graduate. He's commanded at the squadron and group level. Now, I did have the opportunity to fly with you, Smack, back in the day, so it's great to see and hear your voice.
Hey, Slick. Thanks for hosting. It's good to see you again and hear your voice. So great to be here.
And finally, we have Mr. Jim Nee. He's an engineer with Lockheed Martin and an expert on numerous systems, including IRST.
Hey, Slick. Thanks for having us.
Now, the experience we have on this panel is second to none, so I just want to let you all know how much we really appreciate you being here. So, Eric, let's kick this off with you. You've got a lot of combat time in the Super Hornet. Can you talk to us about this in the big picture and why this is an important technology right now, especially when we talk about peer competition with countries like China and Russia?
Slick, I think the overall big picture is the understanding and the reality of the fact that where air-to-air radars operate on the electromagnetic spectrum, that's a very highly contested and congested environment. And so along that bandwidth, you've got radars interfering with other radars, and you've got exploitation happening with electronic attack, or EA, in the form of noise jamming, which is overwhelming the environment with clutter to block targets. And you got deceptive jamming that's manipulating that radar energy um, and causing either false targets or manipulating the aspect, the altitude, the range of actual real targets. And all this does is it denies and it delays and it degrades building what's called a weapons quality track to support air-to-air missiles, all right? And I think the other big picture aspect of this is the understanding that radar energy is detectable and it's also targetable. So a transmitting radar gives away positional information, and then there's radar, and then there's air-to-air missiles out there that target on radar energy alone, known as anti-radiation missiles. So I think those are the two big takeaways. When you start talking about near-peer competition, that's standard equipment for fourth and fifth gen aircraft. And then I think when you even start talking about less than near-peer competition, it's really easy to use something like EA to increase the survivability of less capable platforms. And that's where IRST comes into play here. So it allows us to kind of work outside that contested and congested environment in a passive sense, maintain that offensive advantage.
Yeah, Eric, I really appreciate that. Now, Pat, over to you. You've seen both sides of the equation, both as an operator and now on the technical innovation side. How has the mission environment evolved where it's no longer a, quote, nice to have with this sort of technology? It's essential that we have multiple methods of detecting, targeting, and tracking targets. Now, Eric touched on it, but could you build that out a little bit more?
Yeah, absolutely. So like as I reflect back, it's all about, having a series of options to help solve the puzzle. And as players on the battlefield become ever more familiar with how each other fight, and then we get into this, what we call peer-to-peer, right? We have to have options that create advantages to ensure that we have an advantage when push comes to shove. And those contested environments mean that we may or may not have an advantage that we held previously. We know our enemy's working on and watching us for them to be successful, and they're developing ways that will counter our success. So I think IRST is becoming a critical advantage as both of us and our adversaries try to create and deny that stealth capability more than anything, right? And so IRST really, it's about creating advantages for those who have the high-quality systems. And if you can create problems for those that are aware that we have the systems, that's one thing, and then also denying them from using their systems as well. So ultimately, for me, it's about another method of creating an offensive advantage as well as a defensive problem.
No, it's really interesting how you brought that up, the kind of point and counterpoint, because for so long, we've just been used to running on things in a linear fashion because we haven't really been challenged for decades at the high end. And in so many ways, this is like back to the future. It's how we've engaged, whether it be in World War II with lots of competition or through the Cold War. So what you're saying makes a lot of sense. Now, Heather, if we go to any museum, you see a lot of airplanes like the 101 and the F-106. And you see really early Earth Seekers on the nose. And it's surprising and impressive given that folks over 50 years ago figured out this initial form of the technology. Can you explain to us how this idea came about and how it evolved?
Exactly, Slick. So the F-101 and the F-106, which you referenced, were early fighter interceptors that Air Defense Command used to try to intercept Soviet nuclear bombers from being able to invade and bomb the homeland of America, right? And the problem was that fighter fire control radars were very short range. And in order to defend against these nuclear bombers, they had to go really far, but they couldn't see that far. So IRST was one of the ways that we tried to crack this nut, right? Because a supersonic bomber or even any airplane up in that cold sky is really hot. I mean, just think about the heat that the engines are making and the exhaust that's coming out, and even the skin friction as they're moving through air. So these IRST systems allowed these fighters to detect these bombers at much further ranges than their radars could see. But the problem was that this infrared search and track wasn't accurate. Today, I mean, as you've heard Pat talk about, IRST has better fire control quality, right? It can pass a weapons quality track or Q. And today with imaging capabilities, we can even provide that combat identification. And that's really important because as you've heard the guys say, in this contested environment, we're really going to have problems identifying who's a bad guy and who's a good guy. And IRST can provide this kind of combat capability. We've seen it evolve over time. I mean, if you think about it, heat-seeking missiles are just little kind of baby IRSTs, as well as we have similar technology in laser targeting pods. So we've seen this evolve from the F-22's threat detection, which really was designed to look at missile plumes, and has evolved into the F-35 DAS imagery, and even their EOTS, their laser targeting system. So it's really come a far way, and it's exciting to see the potential that this has to be able to provide us a combat advantage.
And just to build this out a little more, you said the early versions weren't accurate, and that kind of cuts to the notion of what it means to have target quality data. And if you can build that out a little bit, because obviously they were accurate enough to say like, hey, the bomber's over this way with a pretty accurate vector, but actually giving coordinates for a missile kill is totally different. And can you talk to us about that?
Absolutely. So the weapons quality track, or Q, really needs to be much more refined in order to be able to provide the right directional data for the missile. Because if you think about it, the seeker head on the missile doesn't have the broader aperture that your infrared search and track system will have. And getting close sometimes isn't good enough for the fusing systems on those missiles. So you really have to have that fine granularity of location, as well as where the bad guy is moving to. Remember, this is air combat. So you have, you know, relatively small aircraft in a huge chunk of sky moving at really fast air speeds in a three-dimensional environment. So having that kind of real granular grain track is important to be able to pass to those weapons so that they have good location data to aim.
Yeah, thanks for that. Now, Jim, I just want to say up front, I am really impressed with your background. To actually help engineer this technology is incredible. I understand it conceptually, but you're one of the folks who actually turns theory into reality. So, big picture, can you walk us through how this technology functions? And we obviously need to say unclassified, but what does it mean to detect electromagnetic radiation in the infrared spectrum?
Sure, Slick. So the infrared, right, is part of the electromagnetic spectrum, which is just huge. It lives right outside of visible light. So, and we detect that energy really as heat. So it's you know, it's radiated and it's detected as a heat signature. And so if you think about the kinds of things we're trying to search for and track as an air-to-air capability, we're looking for aircraft flying at high velocities, we're looking for missiles, and all those things generate heat no matter what. It's just physics, right? Anything passing through the atmosphere at any substantial velocity is going to give a heat signature. So that's what an infrared search and track system is out there looking for, right? It's scanning and sanitizing a large volume of space, looking for those points of heat. So that's one of the things too that, you know, when we think about infrared search and track systems, there's different bands also within that infrared spectrum. There's the midwave band and the long wave band. The long wave band happens, there's a lot more radiated energy within that. And that's a lot of the skin friction heating. And that's really where a lot of today's IRST systems operate, because they are looking at very long ranges. So they want to have the best shot of detecting energy at very long ranges. So, you know, we're not an imaging sensor. That's another clarification I want to make, right? Infrared search and track is out there searching for points of heat. And the best band to do that in is the long wave band. So that's really kind of in a nutshell, infrared search and track and IR in general.
Well, thanks for that. That was a great explanation. So Eric, talk to us about passive detection. Why is it important and how does it differ from active forms of detection like radar?
So active detection with radar, right? Those are transmitters that are pushing out energy and it's bouncing off a target-like object and coming back to a receiver. And I've already talked about some of the problems with that in terms of electronic attack and the fact that energy is detectable and targetable, right? But there's other problems with that, with technologies like radar absorbent materials and then specifically angled surfaces that deflect that energy or suppress that energy from coming back to the receiver, right? So just like Jim said, getting into the passive environment and getting into the infrared spectrum, you kind of get outside of that congested and contested environment and looking for those heat sources, or the difference between those target-like objects, the heat from that, and then the outside environment. And then I think what Heather said was really critical was the advancement of IRST, and the fact that IRST alone can provide those weapon quality tracks at tactically significant ranges is really a key aspect to this, to keep fighters on timeline while conducting intercepts.
Awesome, thanks for that. So Pat, with countries like Russia and China developing stealth aircraft, how does IRST provide our pilots a unique technology to help ensure we don't fall victim to the key technologies we've been using against our adversaries?
Yeah, it's a great question, Slick. And ultimately, you know, back to the stealth, right? As Drag mentioned, the aircraft are uniquely shaped, so they deflect the radar energy, or they have some coating of some fashion on there to absorb that energy, ultimately to keep the signal from returning to the source, right? So with IRST now, as the countries, the peer-to-peer are developing their own stealth, they're trying to leverage the technology that we're very familiar with. Now, IRST is a little different, and it's not looking for something to come back per se, right? It's scanning out there. It's looking for active action, if you will. And what it sees is the light out in the distance, and it turns that light or that heat that Jim talked about into a detection, into targeting information that the warfighter can then leverage to their advantage. As you can imagine, right, the bigger the platform or the faster it's traveling, the more heat it's going to create. And that long wave sensor that Jim talked about, it loves that. And so a large platform going fast, we're going to see it at a pretty significant range. So, but what's the real secret in all of this? And that's the sauce that goes inside on how do you discriminate a real target versus a false target? And that's for really smart guys like Jim and the engineering teams that work in this IR spectrum and these advanced technologies. Really, can dig down and build algorithms to discriminate what's real and what's not real. And then the ultimate goal is we only hand, you know, the IRST sensors would only hand off to the crews what's important to them, so they're not inundated with the false alarms and things like that. But just the simple fact that an aircraft is flying through the air, that's going to enable this technology to see it.
Oh, that's incredible. So Heather, I'm going to turn the tables here. So if IRST is a tool that can help detect stealth, does that mean stealth is dead? I mean, talk to us about how strategic competitions work.
Well, first of all, let me dispel any myths. Stealth is not dead. Stealth is the price of entry to the modern battle space. I mean, you can kind of think about it like trying to get into that great nightclub that everyone wants to go to. If you don't have the cover charge, the bouncer is going to knock you out, right? Stealth is really important, but it's no longer invisible. I mean, we think about it like Desert Storm, where the F-117s were virtually untouchable. That's not true today, but countering stealth with air defense systems and radar technology still provides significant problems to the adversary, especially in the end game targeting. So stealth still provides significant operational value, even though we do see that technological competition advancing. But we also need to point out that IRST isn't infallible also. You know, elements like lasers can counter it, weather and atmospheric attenuation can also decrease and scatter some of that wavelengths. So what we need to understand is that going into the modern battle space, we need to have a number of different methods and phenomenologies that complement each other as we go into this hider and seeker competition. So stealth isn't dead, but IRST is also essential and will soon also become crucial to every aircraft in the battle space.
So what I'm really hearing you say is it's about a range of complementary capabilities that modern weapon systems need. A silver bullet approach isn't going to work, and you really want a tapestry of capabilities to cover you on multiple angles. And I think that's what reflects what we've had throughout history. I think it's crucial for everybody to understand, because you see these headlines where they say, oh my gosh, the sky is falling, this technology is dead. But you know, it's rarely that simple. It means that things are constantly evolving. So Jim, I want to move over to you. I know your team's been working on several iterations of IRST over the last few years. In the early 2000s, we saw it on the F-15, along with options that work with Lantern and Sniper pods. We saw an improved version on the FA-18s, F-15s, and F-16 called IRST-21. And now I understand you have something called the Legion pod. So can you talk to us about this technology and how it evolved and what the main technological advances are here?
Sure. Happy to do that. So I'll tackle the question about IRST first, because really what once we go through that, I think it'll make Legion Pod a little more understandable, because Legion Pod is really just a different packaging of our IRST components, right? The Navy calls them WRAs. The Air Force calls them LRUs, line replaceable units. So they are the Legos of the building blocks that make up the system. So when we talk about the advancements over the last several decades, right? The first one we've hit on, which is the accuracy, turning infrared search and track systems from a situational awareness sensor to something that could actually provide weapons quality information to the platform, right? That was the big change for the systems. The second is just the evolution of processing power that has happened over, you know, the last 3-4 decades, right? There's just so much more power that you have in your phone now than what people used to, you know, to send a man to the moon. So, and a lot of our systems are based on the algorithms that are used to distinguish, you know, is that a real heat source? How do I pull it from an environment that's not a blue sky environment, right? There's clouds, there's all kinds of things in the environment that make IRST challenging. So really having the processing power to execute the algorithms needed to find and discriminate the targets from the background was the other kind of major advancement that's made the technology much more relevant, right, for the 21st century. And the third advancement, which we are starting to feel now, is some new detectors, right? So the detector is the part of the system that is converting that heat signature to electrons that the system uses to actually process on. So our latest detectors are effectively doubling the range performance of our Earth systems that were in those legacy systems in the 2000s and even the 2010 timeframe. So really exciting to be part of IRST right now as we push out to some of these incredible ranges and what that means to our defenses. So very cool. And then those capabilities are all, they're the upgraded LRUs or WRAs. And our Legion Pod product is basically packaging those IRST components into a pod that can now go on the F-15, on the F-16. So it's transportable between those platforms and on UASs, actually. We're actually working on some UAS technologies as well and putting it onto there. And that particular system actually has volume, power, cooling to add other things like data links, right? Which and other payloads, other sensor payloads that you can combine with IRST to make an even more formidable capability.
Yeah, that's impressive. You know, it just shows oftentimes people fixate on the actual airplanes, but in the modern era where the game is really changing, it's within the systems that function within the aircraft that is the true technology here. And that's where we're breaking boundaries. And to hear you run through it is really impressive. So from a macro level, and obviously keeping it unclassified and all that, can you talk through some of the big picture lessons learned that you've learn through the journey, because you're really on the cutting edge?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've been working in IRST for 40 plus years now. And there's been a lot of people before myself. We do this as a team that have just broken through and made advancements over the years. And I'll tell you, there's a lot of lessons learned. And I think the principal one is that these systems take time to mature. Right. We still to this day continue to fly, continue to get data, continue to make our systems better. It's not something that you can easily pop out, you know, in the span of 5 years, starting from a blank sheet of paper. It takes a lot of time. The environments that you're up against always vary. So there's always something to be learned. The algorithms are constantly evolving. To make the system better. And the fact that we've been doing it for 40 years means we just have a lot of data. We have a lot of those lessons learned to make the system, you know, do what it's supposed to do without giving the pilot a whole bunch of false alarms, you know, because we do see everything. That's the thing with IRST. We see every source of heat out in the environment. And the trick has always been, okay, which ones are real? Which ones should we be worried about? Which ones are just maybe, you know, just pure clutter? So getting to the real tracks that matter is very difficult, and it takes a lot of time, a lot of flying, a lot of data. So that's the first, I'll say, lesson learned. The second major lesson learned is IRST on its own can be very capable, but it can be lost if it's not integrated, you know, well with the other aircraft systems, right? And really, just like we talked about earlier, how it's just another tool, and its real power comes in how it's how it plays with the other systems on the aircraft. That means the integration of the capability into those aircraft systems is all that much, all that more important to showcase the capability of IRST.
Well, I said on the front end here that I was super impressed with your background, but now I'm even more. So it's just incredible work. So Pat, I understand that IRST isn't just for fourth generation aircraft. Fifth generation types like the F-35 have a version of IRST through its distributed aperture system, or DAS. Can you explain the mission value that it provides, especially when it comes to target ID or identification functions and range to produce a first shot, first kill advantage?
Yeah, absolutely. And not only is it in the distributed aperture system on the F-35, but the electro-optical targeting system also has IRST functionality, which is more of a, so, you know, scanning and a steering array both on the F-35, which gives us some nice capability. But, you know, as Slick, as you remember from our time in the jet, we really never used a single point of information to complete an ID matrix, right? And so IRST is just another tool in the toolbox now that, you know, you and I didn't have the luxury of using so much on the F-16, but certainly a player moving forward. And like we talked about, because it's really long range and we're really talking about heat sources, that long range, you're probably not going to get a quote unquote ID just solely off of the IRST track itself. However, it may be an opportunity now to focus other sensors and other capabilities on your platform and really focus in on, I mean, we get really good angle with the IRST. So I can point those sensors down that angle line and then let them do their work to try to figure out ID and whatever method that they could use to do that. So it's really about, you know, having more arrows in the quiver to make decisions with and kind of focus other efforts on. And IRST will always be a contributor, but it's, I don't think it's ever going to be a, you know, a sole source when it comes to ID in particular, but it is certainly a big piece and can fill in a lot of missing things out of a kill chain.
Yeah, so again, it's all about the ecosystem to make it happen. And we hear a lot about the joint all-domain operations where exchanging information is the key to raising everyone's game in the battle space. How does IRST contribute to that concept?
Yes, look, you referred to JADC2, so joint all-domain command and control. So it's a component, a function of net-centric warfare. And those are networks that are talking to each other and quickly sharing information from various platforms and sensors designed to quickly close the kill chain and really match the best weapon available to that target. So IRST is a contributor to that massive effort. And I can kind of see it applying into two areas, you know, on a local level with maybe a division of fighters trying to prosecute a division of threat aircraft. You know, those fighters share information through a simple network like Link 16 to be able to work through that problem, whether there's EA there or not, to prosecute that target. But then on a more broader context, that sensor and that information, specifically on the ID component, getting pumped into a broader network that's solving bigger problems and providing, you know, commanders with the best information available to respond with the best weapon in the quiver. So I see that that's how kind of IRST and JADC2 will interact.
I appreciate that. Now, Pat, coming back to you, I understand that this technology was also showcased at the Northern Edge exercise recently, and I gather that data link was a key component to making this all happen. So can you talk about any of the key takeaways from that exercise?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, exercises like Northern Edge, they're just fantastic opportunities for warfighters to test drive technology and to develop tactics, techniques, and procedures on how to best employ that. And I mean, let's face it, you know, you hand technology like this to smart captains who are applying the platforms, and the technology only gets better once they apply their tactics and techniques to them. So the exercises do give us a great opportunity to understand and learn and test, and then how can we really create an advantage, right? And so we're all learning about IRST, and the exercises are a way to do that. you can learn fast through the exercises. And what we learn is, particularly Northern Edge, is, you know, IRST is kind of immune to that dense jamming environment and all the noise that's going on that that Eric was talking about earlier. So it helps us to get smarter, and it helps the warfighters create the techniques that we talked about. And, you know, with the data link and why that's important, you know, the 4th-gen fighters are a little, limited with respect to how much bandwidth they can process. And back to the processing discussion. So if we can do some of that with a data link between a couple of pods and only concern the platform with what is real and what we have determined through the data link, then that's just less horsepower we're asking from the platform to help create solutions and identify targets for the pilots. In the Northern Edge in particular, the current data link on that was TTNT, was provided to, you know, customers were very happy with what they saw, and we'll continue to refine on that. We got a lot of great lessons learned out of it. But, you know, the data link is really just, now you have two eyeballs out there, so I'm able to create a three-dimensional view of what's going on. So not only is my angle really good from each of the pods, but when they're communicating with each other, now I can get really accurate range information. So tightening down that weapons quality, that cue, if you will, is the real benefit to be a data link as far as it's concerned.
Yeah, it's incredible. Kind of like real-time triangulation on a target out there. So to build this out further with broader training exercises, my understanding is that IRST is a growing requirement for things like red air. Is that what you're seeing as well?
Yeah, absolutely. And that goes back to training for how you're going to fight. We know our adversary has IRST capability. You can read up on that on any open press. And so as we build our tactics and techniques and how we're going to fight with it, we also need to understand how we're going to have to survive against it, because the systems are out there and they're proliferating. So we tried, back in our day, we tried many things to defeat a radar, right? And so some of them worked, some of them didn't. But we figured out what did and what didn't, and built our tactics around that. And the same thing is going to apply with IRST. Over time, we'll get smart on what really works well, what doesn't work well. And then having red air carry that capability as we train, that'll help us experiment and figure it out faster. I think it's a huge advantage that we continue to train how we're going to fight, and we solve these problems in a training environment as opposed to a real combat scenario.
Oh, it's great to hear. And, you know, it's innovation. It's not something that you can just flip a switch on and it's going to work the first time. You got to play with it. You got to fail some. You got to win some just to keep the momentum moving forward. So it's good to hear that. Now, we're running short on time here, but I've got two questions that I wanted to ask. And the first one to Jim, where do you see this technology going now?
Yeah. So I think about that every day. It's on my mind nonstop. And I'll tell you, you know, I think getting the infrared search and track information, right, published out onto the networks for JADC2, as we talked about earlier, I think will be a really important component as we go into these future fights. It's great data, and right now, you know, it's limited to the platforms that IRST is flying on, but imagine the power of getting that pushed out onto the broader network and being used by other platforms in the fight. And also, you know, to play off that, incorporating other sensors, right, either on the platform or from off platform into that decision matrix, more directly plugged in with the infrared search and track data. I think those are two major trends near term that we'll see. I think, you know, obviously machine learning, AI is all the buzz, and that'll play a role for sure in infrared search and track and making those systems better. And, you know, as you see it, you know, the infrared search and track, it's not just about the technology too, but where it's placed. So going from manned platforms, as well as seeing it move to unmanned platforms, taking a really, you know, outstanding infrared search and track capability and getting onto some unmanned platforms and playing in that larger networked warfare environment, I think is where the future is going. So I'm very excited to see where it goes and to be part of that.
Oh, that's awesome. And again, just the accelerated innovation curve that you guys have been on in recent time is just eye-watering. And to think where you're going is really impressive too. So Eric, last question to you. I just want to wrap this up with a flying story to make it operational again. And take us to the cockpit on a mission and tell us how you see IRST in action, and walk us through a scenario of really how you see this playing out.
Yeah, sure, Slick. And I don't have any firsthand experience with IRST, so normally I'd give you a there I was story, right? Where flak is so thick you could walk on and there's bandits flying everywhere. But like any good aviator would do, I'd exaggerate the story significantly. But conceptually, where I see this really playing a role is fighters going out in an environment, an expected dense EA environment, and they're still building track files at tactically significant ranges and staying on timeline while prosecuting targets. And so this goes back to what Pat was saying earlier about, and Jim, about the sensor is not working by itself, and it's sharing information with the other sensors on the aircraft. And together, that suite of weapon systems is working through the problem and sharing information among the fighters and keeping the fighters on timeline to shoot when they plan to shoot and defend their aircraft when they plan on defending their aircraft, which is a real key and important concept to the air-to-air fight. I also see this being incredibly important when you start targeting low radar cross-section stuff. So when you start talking about cruise missiles or fifth generation aircraft, and then what Jim was saying about not building a bunch of false targets out there, because nothing derails an intercept like chasing ghosts or chasing UFOs, as we see in the news here lately, right? So you got to have the confidence that what you're seeing on your scope is real, and you're able to build a tactic to combat that. So I think that's really important. And then the final thing, I go back to just the fact that classic radar energy is detectable and targetable. So there may be times where you want to start limiting your emissions and you might want to turn everything off and go into silent mode. And right now, if aircraft do that, for the most part, you lose the situational awareness of the fight. You're pretty much going back to World War II and eyeballs out and looking for bandits, right? So IRST is a capability to maintain that situational awareness when you want to bring the emissions down and remain less detectable and targetable. So that's where I see it really playing a factor in the modern air-to-air combat role.
Oh, thanks for that. Now, you guys have been awesome. Thank you so much. The insights you've brought to this episode have been great. To hear from the operators and the technical experts all at the same time, it really brings in some important perspectives to the subject. So from all of us here at Mitchell, I really want to say thanks. We really appreciate you guys being here today.
Thank you, Slick.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Slick.
With that, I'd like to extend a big thank you to you, our listeners, for your continued support and for tuning into today's show. If you like what you've heard today, don't forget to hammer down on that like button and follow or subscribe to the Aerospace Advantage. You can also leave a comment for us to let us know what you think about our show or areas you would like to hear more about. As always, you can join in on the conversation by following the Mitchell Institute on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, or LinkedIn, and you can always find us at mitchellaerospacepower.org. Until next time, this is John Slickbaum. Stay safe and check six.